And now the last in our series of programmes which have been celebrating the 100th anniversary of the birth of Walt Disney. Russell Davies looks at how the archives have treated the two faces of the man, Uncle Walt, who brought laughter and pleasure to millions, and the rather tougher businessman and social engineer, Double Disney.
My role, well, you know, I was stumped one day when a little boy asked, "Do you draw Mickey Mouse?" And I had to admit I do not draw anymore. "Well, then you think up all the jokes and ideas." "No," I said, "I don't do that." Finally, he looked at me and said, "Mr. Disney, just what do you do?" "Well," I said, "sometimes I think of myself as a little bee. I go from one area of the studio to another and gather pollen and sort of stimulate everybody. I guess that's the job I do."
Thus spoke Walt Disney in his well-rehearsed avuncular mode, a man who probably talked more easily to children than to adults, and who was answerable to the child within himself. There were those in his employ who thought of Walt as a bigger bee than he would have wished, but we'll come to those. The archival voices who speak most kindly of him are the child stars who worked for him, like Hayley Mills and Roddy McDowell.
I'd gone out to have lunch and have a meeting about that darn cat with the director, and Walt came in, and the next 5 hours, he was taking me all over the studio, showing me how everything was working. He was like the great toy maker, you know, and really loved it. It was lovely to work there. I mean, it was very well organized. I used to just sit and watch how they did it. It was fascinating, fascinating. And that was filmmaking at its most imaginative. The way they would storyboard and the amount of shots that it took to get the cat to do this, that, and the other. And it was never approached as if it was a burden. It was approached as if it was a wonderful, putting this great jigsaw together, and like a bunch of kids. Great joy, man.
He was actually quite a difficult man to get to know. He was rather an introverted person. He got on terribly well with children, though. He was very relaxed with children and understood them.
Mm.
Hardly surprising. He really did understand what they liked, what made them laugh, how much they liked to be scared, what they really enjoyed. Even his house was a bit like Disneyland. He had a model railway going all the way around this magnificent garden, and every time you went there, you were given a ride on the model railway, you know. And his viewing theatre, you know, all producers in Hollywood, they've got their viewing theatres. And you recline on these reclining chairs, you know, and you watch the latest film. Well, in Walt's viewing theatre, you had the reclining chairs, but you also had behind this enormous great soda bar, soda fountain. And his greatest joy was to make ice cream sodas and milkshakes, and all this kind of thing was going on all the way through the film.
Yeah. You see, one's heard that he was a very charming and a very sweet
very
man.
Charming, yes.
But surely he must have been a tough cookie, because, I mean, he had to work in a very tough business.
And yes, extreme. Yes.
Was there not a tough side to him as well?
There was, but I never saw it personally because, you know, it didn't ever apply to me. But yes, he was very tough because he knew exactly what he wanted. And he ran that studio exactly the way he wanted to do. And no decision was made anywhere in the studio on any level without him okaying it first of all, and yet people really respected him and they really loved him.
Hayley Mills with John Dunn. As a purveyor of stories, Walt never had to justify himself further to children. Adults were more problematical. He always hoped that his own early struggle for success offered in itself some kind of guarantee of his fundamental goodness of heart.
Mr. Martin, you have 2 minutes on the life and films of Walt Disney, starting now. What was the title of Disney's first sound cartoon, which opened in New York in 1928?
Steamboat Willie.
Correct.
Mickey came after a good many years, about 8 years after I'd been in the animated cartoon business. He was sort of a product of necessity, you see. I was in New York at the time, and I'd been producing a series of pictures for a company there. They were about a rabbit, and they were fairly successful, called Oswald the Rabbit. But I lost that. They took it away from me, so I was all alone and had nothing. And I had this mouse in the back of my head. There's some sympathetic quality to a mouse. Why, I do not know to this day. But, so I had this mouse, and I tried it out in Mrs. Disney. I said, I'm going to have this little mouse. I'm going to call him Mortimer.
Mortimer.
And that's just the way she said it, almost. she said, oh, no, not Mortimer.
How right she was.
And too. I said, what's the matter with Mortimer? And I got the usual answer back. I don't know, but I don't like it. See? So I was stuck. So, I mean, I have a little Irish blood in me. So the sort of the euphony of Mickey and Mouse came to me. So I said, well, what about Mickey? Well, she says, I like that better. She didn't say it was good. She said, I like it better. So that was it.
That was Walt in 1953, by which time his own story and the prehistory of his industrial empire had become an important part of what he sold to the world at large. There was a strong message in it about America, the opportunities she offered and the duties she imposed. At the same time, the Disney business was on its way to acquiring some of the characteristics of a small country in itself, with, for example, a national anthem you could march to.
Who's the leader of the club that's made for you and me? M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S-E. Hey there, hi there, ho there, go as welcome as can be. M-I-C-K-E-Y-M-O-U-S-E.
A perky number, animated in every sense, and, importantly for Disney, completely sexless. As Walt knew, Mickey had no vices, and paradoxically, that was a weakness in him. He was hardly anyone's favourite Disney character because he was imprisoned in his own good intentions and conventional behaviour. In the voice that Walt himself provided for him, Mickey was literally squeaky clean.
Have you got a favourite character of your own?
Yes, I have. It might be sentimental, but nevertheless, it has to be, and it is, Mickey Mouse.
Well, you've been together a long time, haven't you?
We certainly have.
Do you still do the voice?
I do, yes.
Would you like to do
it
for us now?
I don't admit it.
Well, it's such a silly thing for a guy like me to be sitting here talking this way.
Well, thank you very much indeed, Mr. Disney. I know we're all very glad to hear that voice again. And I'm glad to hear that you're going to do some more films with Mickey Mouse, too.
John Ellison with Walt in 1949, when tough interviewing was not yet on the BBC's agenda. Nor was it much more punishing 10 years later on the Television Tonight programme, where Walt further explained the consequences of Mickey Mouse's inability to behave badly.
Mickey is very well known around the world, but the duck came along as a result of too many taboos put onto Mickey Mouse. People didn't feel that Mickey could blow his top like the duck. In other words, he had to maintain a certain dignity. So in order to give ourselves the latitude, we created this little duck. It's this terrible-tempered Mr. Duck.
As an outlet for yourself.
Yes, and it gave us the contrast that we needed in the film. Now, I used to team Mickey and the duck together at one time. And also, at one time, I had all four of these characters in one film at one time. Then I divided them up, and each one had his own film. Each one had his own show.
Well, many of the Donald Duck, particularly, seem to show great extremes of cruelty. And this has come up again in a recent film of yours, the accusation of cruelty, with regard to the film of Tonka. Now, is this one which you feel is perfectly justified?
Oh, Tonka, the one of the where the Indians were cruel to the horse?
The horse.
Well, that served as contrast to the boy. Now, the boy really trained the horse with kindness. And it's a little lesson in how to train an animal. Not with cruelty, but with kindness.
But what about the charges of cruelty made against you in relation to the earlier films, the Donald Duck films, the extreme
where we hit him on the head or something?
That sort of thing, yeah.
Oh, I don't know. That comes from, I didn't invent that. That comes from Punch and Judy. I mean, that's been going on for centuries.
So, Donald Duck existed to portray the bad, unreasonable elements of the character that Mickey was not allowed to have. And it was much the same with Walt's own personality, except that the tough, bullying side of himself, the ranting Donald Duck aspects, were kept behind the scenes. Politically and industrially, Walt Disney was not the same endearing figure we've met so far. He was a political force. The sheer size of his business made him so. Even Derek Hart on Tonight sensed it, hence the introduction he gave his guest.
With me is one of the most famous figures of the century, the name probably even better known all over the world than that those of the statesmen who alter our lives. Even the name of Churchill is overshadowed by that of Mickey Mouse. General de Gaulle is a big noise now, but Goofy has been a world figure for a very great deal longer. Khrushchev may dominate world politics today, but Donald Duck has been a global star for nearly a quarter of a century. These are all the children of one of the most remarkable brains of the century, Walt Disney.
Those names, especially Khrushchev, place Walt right at the heart of the Cold War, a spot where he was very much at home. Visitors to his Magic Kingdom realized that, with a bit of a shock in my case, when they saw the theatrical exhibit where a life-size audio-animatronic figure of Abraham Lincoln gave a speech. An eerie experience in itself, but it was what Honest Abe said that caused surprise. Here was an opportunity for Walt Disney to endorse Lincoln's message of freedom and equality for all, but instead, the speech chosen for the living statue to deliver was about the defense of the nation, and it's become extraordinarily topical in these days of terrorist attack.
At what point shall we expect the approach of danger? By what means shall we fortify against it? Shall we expect some transatlantic giant to step the ocean and crush us at a blow? Never. All the armies of Europe, Asia, and Africa combined could not by force take a drink from the Ohio or make a track on the Blue Ridge. At what point, then, is the approach of danger to be expected? I answer, if it ever reach us, it must spring up among us. It cannot come from abroad.
Well, Lincoln was right in one sense, and in another sense he was mistaken. But either way, it's a remarkable passage for Walt Disney to have chosen to highlight. Walt had a particular kind of right-wing temperament that's characterized by the exaggerated fear of the unknown. In that case, it took the form of military paranoia, but in lesser matters, the sense of lurking menace was also present. This is how Disney's old friend and ally Ray Bradbury, the science fiction writer, recalled Walt's motivation in establishing Disneyland.
The average carnival and the average circus in the world is seedy and smells of lion urine, huh? He says, why can't we have a circus that smells a little better, that isn't run by psychopaths? Huh? The average carnival is run by psychopaths and freaks. Huh? We know that. And even when we're kids, we sense there's something wrong with these carnivals and these people who behind the canvases, God knows, are doing what at midnight. Huh? It's druid time, isn't it? The trees move. So Disney wanted a nice, clean place to take his kids. That's how it's Disneyland started. He had all these teenage kids or younger, and he had nowhere to take them. He used to take them to the same park I took my kids to, a little dime place over at Beverly Boulevard and La Cienega, a junky little place, dreadful, huh? So out of that need, he said, damn it to hell, let's do it right.
Doing it right involved further research on how it was being done wrong. And during some of that, the actor Richard Todd, Disney's Robin Hood and a big star of the 50s, was present.
I was staying in New York, doing mainly radio and TV promotions for Robin Hood. And one day, Walt arrived in New York, got in touch with me, said, look, would you come out to Coney Island with me? I only knew of Coney Island as being the kind of, you know, the kind of Blackpool of America. And I thought, what on earth are we going to Coney Island for? Anyway, I didn't wish to, I didn't question him, I didn't wish to bother him either. So I said, yeah, sure, lovely. So we went out to Coney Island, and we went on all the roundabouts and various other things. We ate a massive great dollops of candy floss. And then at the end, he said, I'll tell you why we've done this. I'm going to start a super fun place in California, near Hollywood. And I was just coming here to get ideas. And about a year later, I was in Hollywood. And he said, I want you to, will you come out with me tomorrow to see Disneyland? So I had a preview. We went to see Disneyland the day before it opened. So I was taken all round Disneyland by the delighted Walt, who wanted to have a go on everything himself. He was a boy, you know. He really was boyish. I think Walt used me as a test bed, as a sounding board for his idea, to see how it went down with me. I suppose it affected what he did, in the end, with his Disneyland.
When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you. If your heart is in your dream, no request is too extreme. When you wish upon a star, as dreamers do.
In songs like that, Disney was completely at one with aspirational America, and still is. To dream is to be halfway to achieving. It's overlooked by Disney historians that the voice singing that classic version of When You Wish Upon a Star belonged to Cliff Edwards, alias Ukulele Ike, who was one of the more dissolute Hollywood figures of his day, seriously addictive in drinking, gambling and womanizing all at once. Frank Churchill, who composed all the music for Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs and much of Dumbo, was a sad alcoholic who shot himself at the age of 40. So, representatives of that druid world behind the canvas that Ray Bradbury talked about were right there at work in the Disney organization, but the fact would never be acknowledged. As for the higher culture, Walt had trouble with that. Burdened by the reputations of great artists of the past, he was in danger of sounding like whoever it was in Nazi Germany, probably not Hermann Göring, the experts now say, who remarked that when he heard the word culture, he reached for his revolver.
And as these famous names run through my mind, I begin to feel myself shrinking to about the size of Dopey of the Seven Dwarfs. And the horrid feeling persists that perhaps Dopey is as well qualified as I am to discuss culture in America. As a matter of fact, at times I have even caught myself viewing the word culture with suspicion. It seemed to have an un-American look to me, sort of snobbish and affected, as if it thought it was better than the next fellow. Actually, as I understand it, culture isn't that kind of a snooty word at all. As I see it, a person's culture represents his appraisal of the things that make up life. And a fellow becomes cultured, I believe, by selecting that which is fine and beautiful in life and throwing aside that which is mediocre or phony.
As it turned out, not a bad definition of a personal culture, but the misgiving expressed in the first part of that statement remained with Walt, as did the word un-American, which he used well before the fashion established by the House Un-American Activities Committee. He'd always been a doer first, and a thinker only when obliged.
In the First World War, in which corps did Walt Disney enlist although he was underage?
The ambulance corps.
Correct. In the Dance of the Hours section of Fantasia, what kind of animal is Hyacinth who dances a pas de deux with Ben Alligator?
A hippo.
Correct. What was the name of the company which Disney launched at the age of 20 to make animated fairy tales?
Laugh-O-Grams.
Correct.
Within his own organization, from Laugh-O-Grams onward, Disney wanted to be seen as one of the boys, as he told Movie Go Round in 1961.
I started in as an artist in 1919, and I actually did my first animated films in early 1920. Mm-hmm. And at that time, I drew everything, painted every background and things, and I carried along as an animator and an artist until about the time of Mickey Mouse. Now, when Mickey Mouse came along, there was such a demand, he made quite a splash, and it was necessary then for me to give up the drawing in order to organize and run the organization. Mm-hmm. Because the animation medium, the animated cartoon, is not a medium of the individual.
No.
It's a medium that demands the collective talents. Mm-hmm. Now, that's what makes my my studio strong, is that my boys with me, who've been with me for many years, up to 35 years, some of the boys, they realize that too, and they respect the talents of other artists. And now they will work together. It's awful hard to get artists to work with each other, you know?
Yes.
But I've been able to affect that kind of an organization. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what gives me the strength, mm-hmm. you see?
Yes, exactly.
It's a collective effort.
Teamwork.
Teamwork is right.
Well, it goes without saying that without teamwork, an animated feature is just not going to be made. But whether the conditions were in place for teamwork to be happily carried on is severely doubted by the writer and showbiz historian Dick Vosborough.
What happened really during the Depression, more and more studios were forced to unionize, almost over the dead bodies, I was going to say of the moguls, but it was almost over the dead bodies of the strikers. And Disney, finally, about the time that they moved to their new expensive studios in Burbank, it was just decided that the Depression was nearly over, and a lot of these people had been with him since 1933 and 1934. They'd been patient. They'd endured puzzling wages. I mean, for instance, there was one animator who got $300 a week, which was pretty good, and his assistant got $30 a week. And this was one of the reasons why they struck. They just felt, a lot of people who were making good money still felt it was an unethical war that he was waging against them. Poor conditions at their previous studio in Hyperion Avenue. They had a projection room that was tiny, and it was called the sweat box because there was no air conditioning. And nobody was allowed to grow a mustache, except, of course, Walt, who had one. And you weren't allowed to take incoming phone calls. And, of course, you certainly weren't allowed to make phone calls out. And you weren't allowed to whistle while you work. Anyway, the conditions were pretty appalling. And Pinocchio, which demanded an enormous amount of overtime, the men received no overtime money for working late at night, and woe betide you if you were the last person out and didn't turn off the light bulb. But they were given, all these overtime workers on Pinocchio, they were given 45 cents to buy a meal later. Because the guy was all heart.
It was clear that Disney operated a star system of his own. His leading animators were stars, but their assistants and fillers-in were seen as merely extras and paid accordingly. By 1941, industrial action had become the only means left for moving things on.
Which Disney artist animated the Queen in Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs prior to her transformation into a hag? Ward Kimball, known as Art Babbitt.
Who were the ringleaders of the strike, as he would see it?
Well, Art Babbitt was a fine animator, but he could forget that later because Babbitt dared to cross him. On one occasion, he was talking to a loud hailer when Walt drove up, and he shouted out, "Walt Disney, you ought to be ashamed of yourself." And Disney let out a sort of animal cry, or shouted, "Come on, sick him, Pluto, get him, boy," and leapt from the car, tried to hit him.
Art Babbitt's own recollections showed that there was already ill feeling between him and Walt long before the studio strike occurred. One incident suggested how bothered Walt was by manifestations of culture.
He found out that I was taking piano lessons in the very early 30s because I was certain that a picture like Fantasia was inevitable. And so I started from scratch and with Volia Kosek, who was a very fine teacher, who figured that in a generation or two she could take me from nothing to an easy Chopin etude, which she did succeed in doing. And Walt heard about my taking piano lessons, so in the presence of many people, maybe 50 people at a huge story meeting, he called me on it. He says, "I understand you're taking piano lessons." I said, "Yeah, that's true." He said, "What the hell's the matter with you? Are you some kind of a faggot or something? I don't know if that's the way you tell."
During the 1941 strike, Art Babbitt was indeed a leading dissident, though the organisation was reluctant even to give him the satisfaction of being recognised as such. In at least one Disney history, he's simply referred to darkly as the striker.
Disney was, and so was his brother, an America firster. This is 150% American, you know. You cannot be more patriotic. And he found a communist under every bush. He called me in his office one day, and he says, "Art, you know, my father was a socialist." I said, "Well, that's fine. So is Mussolini, and so is Hitler." Roy Disney called me. He said, "If you don't stop sticking your nose in other people's business, you're going to get your nose cut off." The way I would organize people, I'd take each department, say the inkers, for example, and invite 8 or 10 of the inkers to my home. I lived Hollywood style in that time, unlike now. And there would be lots of drinks and very nice dinner and two colored servants to wait on everybody and so on. And then I would make my union pitch. Before that period, I had tried to get a raise for my assistant, Bill Hertz, a $2.50 raise. And all hell broke loose. Went through all the various heads and authorities and so on, and finally got to Disney. I called him and wondered how come this assistant, Bill Hertz, can't get a $2.50 raise. And that was when Disney said that, you know, "You and your communist friends, you don't know what the hell's going on in the rest of the world, you know, and if he was worth it, he'd be getting it." And he says, "That's why nobody likes you." That's what hurt me.
In a 1941 address to his workers, Walt pulled out all the traditional tactics of the self-made man, justifying everything in terms of personal privations he'd undergone in setting up the business. For Walt, a complaint could not represent a legitimate grievance. It was, by definition, a whinge.
"I have been flat broke twice in these 20 years. Once in 1923, before I came to Hollywood, I was so broke I went 3 days without eating a meal. And I slept on old canvases and chair cushions in an old rat trap of a studio for which I hadn't paid any rent for months. Again, in 1928, my brother Roy and myself had everything that we owned at that time mortgaged. It wasn't much, but it was all we had. Our cars had been sold to meet payroll. Our personal insurance bored on to the limit to keep the business going. And it might be interesting to you to know that nobody ever, whoever worked for Disney, has ever missed a paycheck during any of these periods. It was over a year after Mickey Mouse was a success before we owned cars. And that was a truck that we used for our business on weekdays and for pleasure on Sundays. You can't accomplish a damn thing by sitting around and waiting to be told everything. Be a pioneer and go out and discover something for yourself. If you're not progressing as you should, instead of grumbling and growling, do something about it."
All the strikers' complaints, of course, concerned matters about which they themselves could do nothing. That was the point. It was probably the Japanese at Pearl Harbor who saved Disney from a continuing cycle of such strikes. Considering how long the personal dispute between Disney and Art Babbitt persisted, with Babbitt being endlessly reinstated and re-dismissed until he finally left to take his huge knowledge of the animation trade into the wider world, it's remarkable that Art could find anything positive to say about his former boss.
"Well, actually, he had no knowledge of draftsmanship, and no knowledge of music, and no knowledge of literature, no knowledge of anything, really, except he was a great editor. And he could spot something that was wrong in a piece of work. Many times he couldn't tell you what was wrong, nor could he ever tell you how to fix it. But he could spot it if it was wrong. He was a great editor."
"I basically make the films to satisfy myself. Mm-hmm. And of course my severest critics are right there in my organization."
"Really?"
"Yes, I have to fight them sometimes. They say, "Well, now look, this isn't Disney." I say, "Well, wait a minute, I'm Disney." And I buy it, you know?
Yeah, sure.
But I don't make films for... I don't care what the critics say. It's the public, you see. The critics sometimes are lose contact with the public. Mm-hmm. So I make all my films for the public, and I'll stand judgment before the public.
Voice of Dickie Jones as Pinocchio. Disney's big animation features were usually received in their day with a kind of simple gratitude that film critics no longer keep in their repertoire. It might be different if we had a Graham Greene review of an early Disney, but no such thing exists in sound. Instead, we have C.A. Lejeune, certainly a pioneer film reviewer, and her reaction to Bambi in 1942, aimed, as Walt would have wished, at children.
I think you'll agree Bambi was worth waiting for. Of course, you can pick holes in it here and there. Disney's still not as good on his big animals as his little ones. The full-grown stags are a bit chunky, a bit boneless, rather like the centaurs in Fantasia. But if you've ever tried drawing horses, you'll know how difficult they are. And I suppose centaurs are much the same thing, even stags for that matter. Still, most of Bambi's absolutely enchanting. All the first half's about young animals. Of course, no one can beat Disney on his young things. Starts off with the excitement in the forest the day Bambi's born. The owl, all the rabbits, the birds, and the little creatures coming to look at the new baby, watching him try to stagger to his feet, take a few tottery steps away from his mother. Then you see him growing a bit bigger, learning to talk, and playing with the young rabbits. There's a marvelous rabbit called Thumper, who's always getting into trouble for saying the wrong thing. He lisps a bit because he's lost one of his first front teeth. And he and Bambi go sliding on the frozen lake together. Come on, he says, the water's quite stiff. It's charming, all this part. And there's a lovely scene where Bambi feels the first drop of rain. All the seasons, snow, the spring fields, the red leaves, they're done most beautifully. Then as Bambi grows older, he learns about man and how dangerous he is. You never actually see a man, but you hear shots, the sound of a horn. There's a terrible panic in the forest, all the mothers hurrying their children into holes and thickets. Bambi's own mother's shot, as a matter of fact, and he's brought up by an old stag, the king of the forest. Of course, in time, Bambi's voice breaks, and so does Thumper's, and Thumper gets both his front teeth and grows up into a handsome buck rabbit.
I assume it was aimed at children anyway. C.A. Lejeune in August 1942. The wartime years also brought to the world's screens an extraordinary film from the Disney studios, incorporating Mickey, hippos in frills, and other startling images allied to popular classical music. It all turned into Fantasia, of course, an animated masterpiece where the orchestral conductor, however, appeared in vision as himself.
Most fascinating. He was an extraordinary man, and we became friends and worked together in a spirit of friendship. But by making such a film, the music, the greatest music like Bach in the past and Stravinsky of today, can be heard by persons, by millions of persons who go all over the world to cinema and perhaps never go to a concert hall. So then they have the experience of finding that Bach and Stravinsky are not so painful after all.
Leopold Stokowski interviewed three decades after Fantasia. The world war in progress in that period required Walt Disney to swerve a little out of his normal commercial paths.
In one of Disney's instructional films made during the Second World War, what was the winged scourge of the title?
Malaria. The fly.
The mosquitoes, I'll accept that.
Walt contributed to the war effort, but learned very little from the conflict. He didn't notice, for example, that the life of the armed forces was accelerating changes in the status of black Americans. If he had, he wouldn't have made his big feature of 1946, The Song of the South, a version of the stories of Uncle Remus, a happy old plantation slave.
It happened on one of them zippity-doo-dah days. Now that's the kind of day when you can't open your mouth without a song jump right out of it. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay. My, oh my, what a wonderful day.
plenty of sunshine heading my way. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-ay. Mr. Blue.
This was a combined live-action and animation picture, the most ambitious and modern of technical feats, yoked to the most dismally patronizing old source material. It isn't just the voice of today's political correctness that says so. Demonstrators picketed cinemas at the time, with placards reading, "We fought for Uncle Sam, not Uncle Tom." But Walt had been brought up on the Uncle Remus stories, and for that reason he saw no harm in them. In the week of the film's release, the House Un-American Activities Committee announced its intention to inspect the motion picture industry for communist influence. As Dick Vosburgh confirms, Disney joined in with enthusiasm.
When he went in 1947 to Washington as a friendly witness for the House Un-American Activities Committee, that was the very first week of their hearings, he had a lot of wrongs to right, a lot of, because he was a grudge collector. Oh, he was also the vice president of a sinister group called the Motion Picture Alliance for Preservation of American Ideals, which they loved. The House Un-American Activities boys were crazy about that little group. I believe that Ronald Reagan and Adolf Monju and other cutie pies were also members of that particular group. I know that when he took the stand, Walt described commie attempts to subvert good old Mickey Mouse by taking over the Cartoonist Guild, and then went on to say that this strike had nothing to do with bad conditions or low wages or anything like that. In fact, as they spoke, his nose got longer and longer and longer, but they loved him and they congratulated him on being a good American. In that first testimony, he was listing various communist front organizations that had gone out of their way to smear his wholesome family pictures. He listed the League of Women Voters. And the following week he had to return, and this couldn't have been easy for him, and tell the world that what he meant was the League of Women Shoppers. That bunch of radicals. And of course, in the ensuing days, catastrophe had fallen upon the heads of the poor League of Women Voters. They'd canceled subscriptions all over the place and a probably permanently blackened name in a lot of quarters.
What action did Disney take to ensure that his live-action Seal Island was eligible for an Academy Award in 1949? And you may answer.
He shortened it.
No, he booked the film into a Los Angeles theater for a fortnight in December 1948 in order to make it eligible for the awards.
Walt and his advisors showed increasing astuteness in such matters, and once post-war prosperity had begun to grow, the fortunes of the Disney commercial empire grew with it. To get in on the latest Disney material was something even veteran artists needed to do.
This is Henry Hall speaking, and tonight is my guest night. It is now my very great pleasure to welcome back to my program that supreme artist that we all love so much, ladies and gentlemen, Gracie Fields.
Well, our next songs are from the film, Walt Disney's film, Cinderella. Cinderella, Cinderella, all I hear is Cinderella. From the moment that I wake up till shades of night are falling, there isn't any let up. I hear them calling, calling. Go up into the attic and go down into the cellar. You can do them both together, Cinderella. How lovely it would be if I could live my fantasy. But in the middle of my dreaming, who is screaming? Cinderella, all I hear is Cinderella. Take a mop and mop the ocean, then give the stars a dusting. The hinges on the fringes, in heaven need adjusting. I go around in circles and I don't know what my aim is. All I know is that my name is Cinderella.
Within Walt's lifetime, though not always since, the Disney songs remained some of the best advertisements he had for his output as a whole. But even in this profitable domain, he was capable of driving a hard bargain, as Alan Dell once found in an interview with Peggy Lee.
Let's talk about Lady and the Tramp.
Well, Alan,
it was so much fun doing that score that first we went out to the Disney studios and I met Walt, which was wonderful. He was a charming man, full of enthusiasm. First he said, these are the storyboards and I'd like to either look at them and see where you think there could be songs, which Sonny and I did. And the songs are where we said. And then we went out to write them. He heard the demos and said, would you consider doing the voices? So I wound up doing four voices. As a result, Sonny and I received, for writing the score, $500 each, total sum of $1,000 for the whole score.
Oh my goodness.
That now seems really incredible because they have made hundreds of millions of dollars on that film.
An unsightly legal wrangle over just payment continued for years, ending at last in the award of $2 million to Miss Lee, a sum which cost her a good deal of her health and strength to obtain, and which she's always regarded as derisory.
What a dog! What a dog! He's a tramp, but they love him. Breaks a new heart every day. He's a tramp, they adore him, and I only hope he'll stay that way.
There's a contrast to be drawn, actually, between the Disney of the years of international syndication and theme parks and the folksy Disney family feeling that, back in the 30s, really had existed for a while. The novelist and screenwriter Richard Condon, appearing on Desert Island Discs with Michael Parkinson, testified to that.
Walt was a very pure man, and I must say a very innocent man in the sense that he was childlike in the way he discovered things and the way he developed things.
Mm.
Well, for example, when I went to work there in 37, they were the last of a series of shorts about to start the big program of Snow White and Pinocchio and so forth. One of the shorts was called The Practical Pig, and it was based on the three little pigs of the Depression years, Who's Afraid of the Big Bad Wolf, and all that business. I was in charge of publicity, and I made a tie-up with National Pork Week, which represented 8,700 retail display windows in the United States, into which they were going to put two big framed one-sheet cards that were going to sell The Practical Pig. Well, Walt came to New York. I was working in New York, he was working in California. He came to New York. And he said, Dick, how could you do such a thing? He said, there are actors. He said, how would you like it if you were working for Louis B. Mayer and you went to Mayer and you told him that you'd made a tie-up with the National Undertakers of America for Clark Gable and Greta Garbo? How do you think he'd like that? He's a wonderful, wonderful man. No, but the most wonderful part about the guy is he didn't fire me.
But he went through life believing the pigs were on the coast.
They were his actors. we had a wonderful thing called the Museum of Science and Industry in New York, right down the street from Radio City Music Hall. And this was at the time when the Disney brothers were so low on funds that it was possible that they weren't going to be able to continue. And we got all of these animation drawings and all of this artwork from the studio, and they put it on display in this museum, and it ran for 6 weeks. Now it was shipped back to this, you know. Roy Disney called me one day, and he said, the shipment of the artwork burned down. He said, two freight cars filled, burned down, he said, on the Arizona border. And I said, oh, my God. He said, how much did you insure it for? So I said, well, I'll look it up. Anyway, I called the museum. They hadn't insured it for a quarter. I hadn't insured it for a quarter. And I had to call the man back. And believe me, they were in dire straits. And say, no insurance, Roy. I said, well, said, those things happen.
Wonderful.
Oh, they were lovely men, those brothers.
At no time from the 50s onwards can one imagine such a catastrophe occurring without the resignation or dismissal of the responsible officer. By 1955 and the opening of Disneyland, you could have been forgiven for thinking that the commercial scope of the enterprise was its chief attraction.
The people and eyes around the world are focused on these 160 acres here in Anaheim, California. This afternoon, Disneyland, the world's most fabulous kingdom, will be unveiled before an invitational world premiere, and you are guests. Art Linkletter will be your host, and with ABC crews and cameras on the spot, will guide you through this truly magic land. You are now in the press room of Disneyland, which is equipped to service over 1,000 members of the worldwide press, here to cover this truly great event. And to start the proceedings, we take you to the entrance of Disneyland and your host, Art Linkletter.
I'm standing here on the railroad tracks with helicopters roaring overhead and cars parking by the thousands. And I'm in front of the big Disneyland and Santa Fe Railroad station. And down these tracks, in just a couple of seconds, will come Walt Disney himself barreling in a railroad train built to 5/8 miniature size. The grounds are loaded with about 15,000 people who are especially invited guests of Walt Disney's. And they're here from movie land, from motion picture and correspondence, from every possible kind of activity connected with the opening of the eighth wonder of the world.
Walt's anti-communist chum Ronald Reagan was on hand to make further introductions.
All activity on Main Street has ceased. And now, Walt Disney will step forward to read the dedication of Disneyland.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land. Here age relives fond memories of the past, and here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future. Disneyland is dedicated to the ideals, the dreams, and the hard facts that have created America, with the hope that it will be a source of joy and inspiration to all the world. Thank you.
Standing here has been one of the most exciting moments of my life. I think, ladies and gentlemen, that anyone who's been here today will say, as the people did many years ago when they were at the opening of the Eiffel Tower, I was there. I'm very proud to say I was at the opening of Disneyland. It's a fabulous thing to happen, ladies and gentlemen.
The children's broadcaster Art Linkletter. Something about the Tomorrowland section of his new enterprise must have stuck in Walt's mind, because it was to the future that he turned for his next big theme park notion. But more than 10 years had passed by the time he announced the new scheme, and by that time, Walt Disney was suffering his final illness.
We call it Epcot. Spelled E-P-C-O-T. Experimental Prototype Community of Tomorrow. Epcot will take its cue from the new ideas and new technologies that are now emerging from the creative centers of American industry. It will be a community of tomorrow that will never be completed, but will always be introducing and testing and demonstrating new materials and new systems. And Epcot will always be a showcase to the world for the ingenuity and imagination of American free enterprise. I don't believe there's a challenge anywhere in the world that's more important to people everywhere than finding solutions to the problems of our cities. But where do we begin? How do we start answering this great challenge?
It must be doubted whether Epcot has ever really addressed those problems in the years since. Certainly Walt himself could put no further imprint on the project, because on December the 15th, 1966, came this radio announcement.
This is Beach Rogers, KFWB News, Burbank. Walt Disney is dead. The man whose name became synonymous with entertainment and fantasy died today at the age of 65. Disney's enterprises never stopped expanding, and at the time of his death, he was full of plans. In 1955, he opened the world-famous 68-acre amusement park, Disneyland, in Anaheim. Disney was also hard at work on a 27,500-acre amusement center in Florida.
And I think Walt would be real proud, because I always used to say, even before Disneyland, in the late 40s, that someday Walt would be better known as an educator, of bringing information to people in a meaningful way. And if this all happens, it'd be kind of fun to have a feeling like that come true. And I think the importance of the project for the guest that comes to Florida as we're trying to present information and knowledge in an entertaining way. And I think the world's ready for that. We have many problems in the world, in our country, in our cities, in our states today, and I think a better informed public will make it easier to solve these problems, and that's just what Epcot is going to do.
Card Walker, the chairman of the board at that time. Of course, many new Disney initiatives have been announced since, some of them quite amusingly.
Et maintenant, je déclare Euro Disney officiellement ouvert.
That was Walt's nephew Roy opening Euro Disney outside Paris in 1992, in the presence of, among others, Michael J. Fox, Gina Lollobrigida, Cher, Tina Turner and Bob Geldof. On that day, an interviewer for the World Service programme Outlook got a rare insight from a Disney official into the training that company employees have to go through. In the Disney sound catalogue, I myself found an item called the Indoctrination Tape, but I wasn't allowed to hear it. Everyone on duty at parks like Euro Disney is a member of the cast, and the cast attends that outpost of Walt's alternative culture, the Disney University.
Yeah, Disney University is our training centre that we have in the company, and we have developed different kind of training for all the cast members. Everybody who is joining the company is going through the Disney University to follow what we call the Disney Traditions Day, where they learn about the culture of the company and why Disney has been so successful during 35 years and in which way they will contribute to the success of the company for the future.
And you give them a piece of paper at the end of that, a degree, a sort of Mickey Mouse degree, do you?
No, we do not give them specific piece of paper. We train them as part of the program, but there is no specific piece of paper.
And what sort of people are you looking for?
We're looking for people that are enthusiastic to work in this type of environment. They like the show, they like to be in the contact with the public, they like the service industry, and they are courteous and smiling.
And young, most of them?
This type of activity is attracting more young people, but we don't have any type of segregation, I would like to say, in terms of age. We are employing people above 18, but there is no limit on the upper side.
And I have heard that you have certain rules and regulations. You teach them to smile in different ways. The men have to smile in a different way from the women. Is that right?
We don't teach people to smile. They are smiling and or they are not smiling, but we don't teach people to smile. What is important for us is when the guest is in contact with our cast member is for them to be welcome, and the smile is the best way for people to be welcome.
So they can smile whichever they like?
Human being is the only animal to smile, to be able to smile.
So that's not true about that Euro Disney specifies the way people are supposed to smile?
They smile the way they want, provided they smile.
So you don't have any rules for your staff, or you do have certain rules?
Yes, we have some rules. As I said, they are the same rules that in the movie industry, when somebody will want to produce a film, they decide about the costume of the actor, they decide the way their actors will be groomed, they will decide about everything to be sure that the quality of the film will be the best. It's the same in our business. We have everywhere a themed location, we have themed hotel, we have themed restaurant, the park is a themed park. Everywhere our cast member will have to have costumes.
So you have themed staff as well?
Exactly. Our cast member play a key role in this environment.
Pierre Jeanvin, in charge of casting and training at Europe's Disney University a decade ago. How charmed would Walt have been by the non-American offshoots of a company that he'd always seen as an embodiment of Americanness itself? How happy would he have been, come to that, to think of himself as anecdote fodder for two old English gents sitting in a cricket pavilion?
I got a message saying Walt was coming to see the show, and would I have
did you call
dinner
him Walt?
With him? I did eventually.
Yeah, not then.
Well, I didn't know him then. Don't interrupt. So, I said to the company manager, he's not in front, is he? I thought it was Robert pulling my leg. It was Robert Morley who's done some murderous things to me from the point of view of... he's rather like you, you
he
know.
Doesn't like cricket?
No, he doesn't like cricket.
Dreadfully loathes it.
No, he doesn't like cricket.
Go on,
anyway, so he sure enough, he arrived and I went out and had dinner with him. And it was a large party, and he said, where are you going now? And I said, home. He said, come and have a drink. We walked up the lane to the Dorchester, and he was in the Oliver Messel suite with a brush and a comb and nothing much else, and a pair of woolen pajamas. And we had a chat, and I got my pen all ready, you see. And then he said, it's lovely to meet you, and I hope we'll meet again. And I found myself going down in the lift. I thought, well, that's very peculiar. And 3 years later, he asked me to go and do a lovely musical.
Which one was that?
Mary Poppins. And when I saw the rough cut of Mary Poppins, you know, loosely connected with Walt and his wife, Bill Walsh, the producer, now sadly no longer with us, and his wife, and Audrey, my wife, myself, I thought it was the worst film I'd ever seen, and I just managed to restrain myself from saying to old Walt, well, you can't win them all, Walt, can you? And it turned out to be
the greatest success.
Next to the Gone with the Wind, you know, until other ones came out. And
you did Bedrooms and
Please get it right.
Not Bedrooms.
You know the title as well as I do. Bedknobs and Broomsticks.
I beg your pardon.
You know you've got a copy. Yeah. Of course you have.
So that was a great success too, you see.
Yes. Two nice musicals.
David Tomlinson with Brian Johnston. So somebody in the days of Mary Poppins knew, even better than an actor in the movie, that it was going to work. And that someone may well have been Walt Disney himself. Certainly something of that judgment, that instinct, seems to have been lost from the corporate Disney psyche since Walt departed. And now, in these recent months when entertainment in general has suffered greatly, Disney has been facing a crisis comparable to any of Walt's earliest struggles against bankruptcy. The evidence of the archive may be deeply divided, as between Walt's Mickey Mouse geniality and his Donald Duck persona, where the self-righteous severity of the self-made man made itself painfully felt. But when it came to sensing what would work, Walt knew best.
Mickey Mouse, to me, is a symbol of independence. He was a means to an end. He popped out of my mind onto a drawing pad 20 years ago on a train ride from Manhattan to Hollywood at a time when the business fortunes of my brother Roy and myself were at lowest ebb and disaster seemed right around the corner. Mickey enabled me to go ahead and do the things I had in mind and the things I foresaw as a natural trend of film fantasy. He spelled production liberation for us.
Double Disney by Russell Davis. The producer was Nick Utekin, and it was a testbed production for BBC Radio 4.